Okay, so this is part two of the really bad thing that I did as a child and kept secret. So my daycare instructor, or whatever you call them, basically said that she had lost her tampon in the water. And I'm guessing she said that because she was on her period and she had a tampon in and the water started turning red, and that's the only reason that she could think of. But like, they started checking all the kids and making sure that all the kids were okay and stuff. And when they came up to me and asked me if I was good, I was like, oh yeah, I'm fine. And so they were looking in the water for like an hour, but there was no tampon. Like, they could not find the tampon. Like, that one white kid, he was not part of the daycare. Like, he wasn't one of the daycare kids. So they evacuated everybody out the pool. Like, nobody was allowed in there. And like, we all got back on the bus and we went back to the daycare. And the daycare instructor, who thought she had lost her tampon, literally talked to all of us and was like, things like this can happen as a woman, and da-da, when you get older, you'll understand. But baby, I stayed mute. Ain't nobody know. One person knows, but hopefully she don't see this on her For You page. Sorry, baddie. Story time about the bestiality children next door. If you don't know what bestiality is, hold on. So I was living in this neighborhood for 5 years. Throughout those 5 years, not one time did my family go and talk to the other neighbors. Why didn't we talk to the other neighbors? Because it's not like we were trying to make friends or anything. We didn't care for them. Well, one day, the neighbor's kids were playing outside while I was playing outside. My mom urged me to go over there and play with the other kids, even though I didn't really want to. So there was a little boy and a little girl. I went over there and I asked if I could pet their dog because they were playing with their dog. They said yes, and the dog started playing with me and started licking my face. Yeah, keep that in mind. Then we started talking about the bus because we ride the same bus. We have the same bus stop. After playing with them for a while, they invited me inside. I asked my mom if I could go. She said yes. So the little boy ran into his room, and then the little girl invited me to her room. So to pass time, I asked her what she does for fun. She said she plays with her brother. And then she asked if I liked animals. Obviously, I say yes, and so she asked to show me a trick. That's when she brings the dog into the room and proceeds to pull down her pants, like for part two. This is part two of the bestiality children next door. Like I said, she brings her dog into the room and pulls down her pants. Totally forgot a very crucial piece of information. I was in fifth grade at the time. That's why I did what I did in these next events. So she pulls down her pants and lets the dog go at it. The same dog that licked my face previously. The dog like went for it. Like, he knew what to do. The only words that I could form was ew. She had trained this dog to do that. So after I said ew, she immediately got up and put her pants up, and like, she was surprised that I was grossed out like any normal human being wouldn't be. Then out of nowhere, she starts crying, and I started feeling really bad, so I told her that I wouldn't tell anybody. And so she tells me I had to switch to my dog because my hamster wouldn't do it. Then she gets up and opens this drawer and proceeds to pull out a dead hamster. She says he wouldn't lick, he would only bite. She starts crying really hard and says she feels uncomfortable and she would feel better if I let the dog do what it did to her. As much as I didn't want to, I wanted her to feel comfortable, so I did it. This is part three of the bestiality children next door. Like I said, I gave in. I didn't know how it was supposed to feel. It felt weird, but it didn't feel good. So I stopped and she started giggling and I just felt so uncomfortable. So I wanted to go home. Then she started acting like she was annoyed and started getting really mad at me. But I was like, whatever. And so she let me leave. Well, it was a Sunday that day, and the next day we had to go to school, but she wasn't at the bus stop. And so I get on the bus and I go to school that day and everything is fine. Until like halfway through the school day, my mom comes to pick me up early. She would never come to pick me up early for no reason. I would usually have an appointment and I would know about it before. I would know if I was gonna leave school that day and was gonna get picked up, but I wasn't notified. So my mom came to pick me up, and while we were on the way home, she said that my dad had stayed home from work that day, and when we got home, we were going to have a talk about what I did with the neighbor's dog. I promise you're gonna wanna like for part four. This is part four of the bestiality children next door. Baby, that rhymed. Like I said, my mom is driving me home right now, and we're gonna have a talk when we get home with my dad about what I did with the neighbor's dog. I tried to explain myself to her in the car, but she wouldn't let me talk. She didn't want me to say anything until we got home. But when we got home, it wasn't just my dad sitting in the living room. The neighbors were there. The mom, dad, and the two kids. So I was like, is this a setup? And the neighbor's dad is fuming. As soon as I walked into the living room, he stood up and tried to get in my face. Mind you, I was in fifth grade. He did that in front of my parents. My parents told him to back up, obviously, but there was a lot of tension. When he was in my face, he was saying, how dare you force my daughter to do that with our own dog? That's when I knew what the fuck was going on. This little fucker. Basically, after I left my neighbor's house the day before, the daughter went up to the parents and told them that I showed her the trick with the dog and forced her to do it. But this is when things take a turn, babes. This is part five of the bestiality children next door. Like I said, my neighbor's parents and their kids and my parents and I were all in my living room discussing about this dog situation. So I went ahead and explained myself that she was a fucking liar and that nothing that's coming out of her mouth was true and that she was just lying and lying. And the neighbor's parents weren't too happy about the fact that I was calling their daughter a liar. Then the mom just lost it and started screaming at me and going at me and just saying all these mean, terrible things. It was almost as if she had a personal problem with me.
Well, baby.
So I started crying really hard once the neighbor's mom started yelling at me. I don't know what that did to the neighbor's daughter, but she folded. She said, I lied. I'll tell you guys the truth. She finally admitted that it was her idea and she's the one who introduced it to me. Then once her parents expressed their disapproval,
this fucking child.
She says, I thought it was okay because I saw mom doing it when dad wasn't home. Story time about how my brother caught me hooking up with his girlfriend. My brother started dating this girl last year and they were hanging out every day. Also around that time last year, I started to figure out my sexuality. Well, since my brother and her would hang out every single day at my house, I would see her all the time. And I started to get little feelings. Something came over me, baby. I was like, God is a woman. I just kind of came to the conclusion that I liked girls. Since she was dating my brother and they were home all the time, me and her kind of started talking too. We exchanged Snapchats, you know, just a friendly exchange. Keep in mind that at the time, she didn't know my sexuality. Nobody did. So that night after we exchanged Snapchats, I was Snapchatting somebody else and I was sending them some explicit pictures. Since I recently just added my brother's girlfriend on Snapchat, her name was at the top. So I accidentally clicked on her name and sent her the explicit picture. I didn't even realize that I did that until I received a snap from her out of nowhere. And she had sent an explicit picture back, like for part two. This is part two of how my brother caught me hooking up with his girlfriend. So like I said, I accidentally sent my brother's girlfriend an explicit picture on Snapchat. Not knowing that I even sent it, I received an explicit picture back from her.
I said, baby, I'll really bite your titty. Stop playing with
me. But after she sent me the picture, I responded with hard eyes. And then she texted me and said that she would be coming over tomorrow to hang out with my brother. I basically said, cool, I'll see you around. And then she came over the next day. So the next day came and she was at my house, but I wasn't talking to her. She was with my brother. And then she walks into my room. I was like, hey, where's Rob? We'll just call the brother that. She said she sent him to the store to get some snacks. I asked if she wanted to come chill on my bed. She agreed.
And right off the bat, we started,
you know, we getting it bonking, having a good time. That's when the door swings open and there my brother is standing at my doorway. Like for part three. This is gonna be part three of the time my brother caught me hooking up with his girlfriend. So my brother swung my door open and there he was standing at my door watching me and his girlfriend while we were. Immediately he was just like, oh really, you're both fucking gross. That's when he turned around and left. Later on, we had to have like a family talk about this and I had to come out about my sexuality to my parents and it was really embarrassing. My parents were super accepting of me coming out, but my brother wasn't as accepting, and I'm thinking it's mostly because of the fact that he had to find out the way that he did. Because it wasn't my sexuality itself that bothered him, it was how he found out. Later on, he told me that he walked into my room because he heard us laughing in there and he wanted to ask her what exactly she wanted from the store. He was gonna ask her if she just wanted to come with, but that's what he walked in on. So my brother went ahead and broke up with his girlfriend. That's when me and her started dating, and we've been dating for about 2 years now. So I said I'd be sharing more stories of things that happened to me while I was younger that I've kept secret for my entire life and haven't told anybody, so here's another story. Fair warning, this video might be a little triggering. I was really, really young at the time. I don't exactly remember what age. I was around 8 or 13 years old. Me and my friends were going to this haunted maze and it was around Halloween time. It was one of my friend's parents that was taking us there and it was a group of 5 or 6 of my friends. While me and my friends were going through this maze, we were standing in a line and I was standing in the very back. So while we were walking, I ended up tripping on my shoelace and I fell to the side where there was curtains. It was the curtains where the workers would pop out and try to scare you. When I fell, I tried to yell for my friends, but because of the sound effects of the maze, they couldn't hear me. And by the time I got up, they were gone. So I started walking and I eventually got to a place where you could only go right or left, and I went left. And once I went left, I ended up in a circular room where there was 5 passageways. But there was also a group of teenage boys and I didn't even see them at first. All I know is I turned around and got grabbed, like for part two. This is part two of the time I got lost in a haunted maze. Like I said, I lost track of my friends and I was looking for my friends and I ended up in a part of the maze where there was all these guys that I didn't even see at first. All I know is I turned around and I got grabbed. So I screamed. I was super young at the time. I was defenseless. I didn't know what to do. Those guys seemed like they were around their teenage years and they were laughing and making a joke out of it. One of them was laughing and they told their friend, grab her legs. And so the friend grabbed my legs and they were tugging me and pulling me. And then they started to pull my pants down. Panic was filling over my body. I couldn't even scream. When you're young, you'd always think you know what to do at these moments, but you really don't. You just freeze up. And that's exactly what I did. I just froze up. But thankfully, as soon as I felt my pants starting to get pulled down, another group of people turned the corner, and that's when the boys dropped me and ran, like for part three.
This is going to be part three of the time I got lost in a haunted maze.
Like I said, another group of people started to turn the corner. That's when the boys dropped me and they ran. Those group of people didn't really get to see what was going on, so they asked me if I was okay. I told them that I was good. Me being super young and scared, I didn't really want to tell them what happened. My parents were also really iffy about me going out, and I didn't want there to be a situation that would make them not trust me anymore. So they started to walk me out of the maze, you guys. And I'm guessing we were nearing towards the exit. But as we were nearing towards the exit, I completely forgot about the boys. I had realized that I didn't have a bracelet that I was wearing. Me being young and trying not to annoy the people that found me and were helping me get out of the maze, I wanted to turn around, but I didn't want to tell them that I needed to turn around because I lost something. So I ran back. As I was running back, trying to find this bracelet in this maze, I had ran into the same group of teenage boys who assaulted me. Like for part four. Of how I almost drowned someone's baby. When this was happening, I was on my phone, so I was distracted. I looked down in the pool and I see that the baby is drowning. I don't really know how to explain the way that my heart skipped a beat at this exact moment. Like, my heart was beating regularly and then all of a sudden it skipped two beats at a time. My ass was in my forehead. Immediately dived down into the pool, took out the baby, but the baby was suffocating. Now listen, I never did CPR, but God blessed me with those skills in that very moment. I was able to keep myself calm and did CPR on the baby and was able to get it to breathe again. I did not tell nobody shit about this. I didn't tell the parents. The baby is fine. I really should have told the parents, because what if it did cause a health issue? But from what I've seen, the baby's fine. Yeah, I didn't tell them what happened, but I quit babysitting because I felt guilty. They haven't said anything about their baby dysfunctioning, so the baby is fine. Just because of this, I pulled myself out of babysitting and I'll never babysit ever again because I'm clearly not responsible enough. This is a story time about the time I dated the school shooter. This might be a long story, so please bear with me. Before you form any opinions on anyone in the story, please wait all the way until the end. Trust me, you're gonna wanna listen to this story time. There was this boy who went to my school and he was really shy and he got bullied a lot. He got bullied a lot because he was a lot more feminine than other guys. And I'm just the type of person to give people the benefit of the doubt, so I went ahead and started talking to him more to see the type of person that he actually was. He didn't sit with anybody during lunch, so one day I went up to him and I sat down right next to him and I started talking to him. Immediately, I loved this boy, everything about him. He was extremely sweet and considerate and understanding, and I knew that if other people took the time to get to know him, they would like him too. So we exchanged numbers and we started to FaceTime a lot. As we started to FaceTime more, I started to notice things that were a little off about him. Every single conversation that we had, he would always have to bring up about how much he hated this one boy in his tech class and how he would shoot up the school just to get rid of him, like for part two. This is part two about how I dated the school shooter. So let me backtrack a little bit from part one. We exchanged numbers, we started to make plans to hang out outside of school, and we just started talking more outside of school, and eventually we started dating. He never really talked about this guy in his tech class until we started dating. Keep that in mind. For some reason, that guy in his tech class really bothered him. Like I said, he started talking about how he would shoot up the school just to get rid of this guy. At first I thought it was just a joke and he was just saying that. Until he kept saying it. He started being so serious about it and he started planning it out and exactly what he would do when he did it. That started to scare me, and so I decided that I was going to record one of these conversations just in case. Well, during that conversation, he said he planned to shoot up the school the next day. He said in these exact words, "Fuck it, you know what? I'm just gonna do it tomorrow." Then he tells me to not come to school the next day. That's when I know that he was actually being serious. Immediately after, I started writing up an email to the school, like for part three.